Disclaimer, these are just lessons that I've learned that helped me get where I am today. Hopefully some of these will resonate with you. It took me a little while to kind of figure some of these things out. I had a lot of bumps along the way because, well, probably like many of you, I kind of felt always out of place. I really started showing when I was at this small little company called XM Radio, where there was a bunch of satellite guys, there was a bunch of people from CBS Radio, which had a, you know, like here in New York, a very New York style of management, which was kind of in your face. And here I am, some computer geek, sitting here trying to figure out how the hell am I going to get this digital music up to these satellites. And then, oh, by the way, we have this problem with big cities like New York and with terrestrial repeaters, which were having a huge problem. And, you know, I'm about 25 years old and no one wanted to believe me or listen to me. So Vice President IT sat me down one day and saying, you know, Dan, you could always be, you know, right, but no one's really going to believe you because you kind of come off as a little bit of a, you know, actually, and then his words were, I was his highest maintenance engineer he had ever had, which I kind of translated that, I was kind of like a diva, which I took that as an insult, but I think it kind of helped me resonate that I need to start interacting more with business people, because if they did not understand what I was talking about from a business perspective, I was never going to get my point across. Which comes to lesson number 9 for me, which is you've got to kind of be a chameleon to me in this industry. You have to learn, you know, we hide in plain sight all the time when we're on the internet. We've got SOC accounts, you know, we know how to anonymize our traffic on the internet, but I had to start learning how to do this in my business life, because I, you know, while I would go to, you know, the different hacker cons, I would not necessarily dress like this. I've kind of found out that I kind of do like putting on a suit every once in a while, but I had to, you know, start interacting with business people. And business people have this aspect, or actually not just business people, but, you know, I'll probably brutalize the aspect, but the out-group homogeneity effect, which basically says we just want to be around people that are kind of like us. And so business people really wanted to be around other business people. And I found that no matter what I did to try to get them to understand the risks associated with that direction they were going in, they didn't care. Because they could never understand that this could potentially be exploited. Because all they care about, as business people do, all I kind of care about a little bit as well, is making money. How are they gonna make money? How are they going to have more of a profit? And so on. Well, I kind of like making money, but better, I like making products that people will want to use and have a benefit to society, which is one of the reasons why I'm here at Silent Circle. So I learned I had to create this business persona, and it was almost night and day. So when I left XM Radio, it happened to be because 9/11 occurred, and I went to go work at Homeland Security. And somewhere around that time, because this company Unisys, they had dress code. So it didn't matter what you had to wear, you know, sport coat, suit and tie all the time. Started noticing, you know, generals, colonels started treating me completely different. And I was trying to figure out why. And I think it came down to they no longer looked at me as just some security professional. Then it was just I'm just some punk kid that they didn't want to listen to, because at that point I was around, you know, 27, 28 years old. And they just wanted to, all they cared about at that point was compliance, which we can see how well the government does that. OPM, you know, amongst others, they, the compliance is not really equated to security. So then I started trying to figure out, I grew up as, you know, playing a lot of sports, and I learned quite a bit when I started playing golf right around 30. This gentleman up here, his name's Harvey Penick. I get two lessons really out of golf. And I think they really resonate quite a bit with just about everything in life, but a lot so in security, which is about being defense or even offensive. No matter how good you are, there's always going to be someone that is better. And no matter how bad you are, you can always find someone that you're better than. And so this is very true when it comes to security, because it's very subjective. I spend a lot of time with, you know, John, we talk quite a bit over here, our other internal business people, because they don't necessarily want to equate that every single vulnerability that we have is a vulnerability. We had this we were debating whether or not to go with a particular ERP system. I won't mention which one it is, but it was not necessarily one that I wanted to go with. And part of that was getting into the next part was getting into golf. You know, I had to learn how to putt. And then the golf aspect, Harvey Penick said that everyone just wants to get up on the driving range and he just wants to hit bombs. That's the easy part. But learning the putt is where you wind up making your money, because that's where you're going to significantly increase your risk posture. So part of that, I had to learn how to basically turn a no into yes, because no matter what I did, an end user was, if they came to me, they didn't like what I said, they're going to do it anyway. So I came out and said, never underestimate an end user on a deadline, because security is in their way, they can and will just go around you, and they do. And part of that's because they're always used to us telling them no. So how could I say yes? Well, I figured out that I don't have to say yes today. I can put certain things in front of them that yes can be sometime in the future. And hopefully we can come up with an agreement that we can say yes to. And so at Silent Circle and at previous places, I have a rule. No one is allowed to say no. They have to find a way to say yes. If they can't figure out how to say yes, then it comes to me. If I can't figure out how to say yes, then I take it to the rest of the executive team. And this is what I had to do with this ERP system. I took it to the rest of the executive team. I laid out all the risks, all the concerns, the potential damage to our reputation in the event that this particular organization was compromised, because with ERP, that's going to have our customer database, it's going to have our HR records, this is going to have everything about Silent Circle that you could imagine, that if it were to show up on Reddit, well, not only am I out of a job, but we're probably, worst case, we're out of business, because we're selling security and privacy. So I couldn't figure out how to say yes to this. It was just really bad. They were using SSL version 3. They were susceptible to just about every vulnerability out there. And their words back to me were, we don't really care, we still need to support Internet Explorer 6. I think that was valuable like in 2008 or 2009 when Internet Explorer 6 was out. I'm going, this is 2015. You know, there's a lot of vulnerabilities that are in SSL version 3, and we're a crypto company. So it didn't matter, the one business person said, we gotta go, we have to do this because of cost. Well, we found out that cost was not really true. I took it to the rest of the executive team. We laid it all out. The executive team in this case felt the risk was too high. Because also, as I put it out there, it's not just me accepting the risk. Now we're business partners, and as a business, we had to accept the risk together. And they weren't willing to do that. So while that sounds sort of, there's probably been limited two times, that was the first time, there was one other time that it didn't go necessarily the way that I wanted, but it was a CEO's call, and it was how we were gonna do some type of marketing. But so far it hasn't really come back to bite us. But what I had to do in this case, as it's part of our overall executive minutes, in the event that it were to come back to kind of bite me in the ass later, I can at least say, hey, you were informed, which is one of the things that I want them to always understand. You're gonna make informed risk-based decisions. So, because I love playing baseball, I wish I could still be playing it sometimes. Another lesson that I learned was the best teams are not made up of a bunch of A players. And you could argue, but to me, being a Yankees fan, the 1998 New York Yankees were the best overall team that ever played. They didn't really have any superstars yet. Derek Jeter was only in his third season at this point. Bernie Williams, Tino Martinez, they weren't superstars. The MVP of the World Series this time was this guy named Scott Brosius, who was a punch and Judy type hitter, which was another kind of part of the lesson I learned from baseball, and that if you give 100%, 100% of the time, you're gonna always come out ahead. Or, in this case, superstar athletes making superstar plays don't win you games. It's the average player making the routine play during game crucial situations is what wins. And when it comes to security, that's kind of where I look at incident response. I learned a lot about incident response from my days of playing baseball, because I'm gonna have to perform and take that SOP and implement it no matter what the situation is. And I have to be able to do that in the event that in the middle of an attack, in the middle of data collection, it didn't matter. If I didn't do that, well, I was possibly not going to be able to catch that bad actor. Or worse yet, which is what happened at a previous company, someone that was a child pornographer. And so if I didn't collect the data correctly, this particular individual was going to wind up going free, because how can you assure that the data wasn't tampered with? But getting back to that, this part, who's going to review the logs? You're not going to have your superstar on your team reviewing the logs. You're not going to have them going through Splunk. You're not going to have them taking care of all the false positives that come out of Nexpose, which I can tell you seems like there's a lot of false positives out of Nexpose, which is a Rapid7 product. They don't happen to do roll up patches very well, but I have to fight with them constantly on this. But I'm certainly not going to look at the false positives constantly coming out of any vulnerability management system. Someone else has to do that. But if they don't all do that, then I can't do my job, which is going with the rest of the executive management team. So I can't be successful unless every single person on my team is successful. And today I have roughly 17 people that report to me at Silent Circle. And I a lot of times feel like I do a lot of babysitting. I'm dealing with a lot of squabbling because, well, in this industry we all have egos. Probably in every industry, but it seems like recently there's a lot of egos. And they need to be talked to a lot. Sometimes they need a kick in the butt, sometimes they need a pat on the back, sometimes they need a shot of whiskey. So I had to start taking a look as well, which is lesson five, business risk versus the type of risk that a lot of us go through. Business people, they care about compliance, because if they're not compliant, they get fined. That's what they were concerned about. HIPAA, Sarbanes-Oxley, Grantley-Wiley, you name it, they're worried about that. They're not necessarily worried as much about being compromised. And you can see this looking at Target. So Target compromised. Today they're trading higher on the stock exchange than what they were before the compromise. Because us as consumers, we also have a short memory. We have, in a lot of ways, forgotten that they didn't do a very good job of vulnerability management, they didn't do a very good job of assessing their operational risk, and they were compromised. But yet, they're not seeing any financial loss. Sony, how many times has Sony been hacked? I've lost count. Because I keep, it was kind of funny. So when I was working for this company called Acuvant, we were assisting in the first compromise. And I was talking to someone that was investigating the last one, and he made a comment that it was so bad at Sony, they continued tripping over the old hacker tools that were left there from the previous compromises. So it didn't surprise me, because I don't think a lot of organizations clean up a lot after anything, right? I think there's still, we probably have a lot of legacy systems that are online, and they probably should be closed. So getting back to business, they're only worried about profit loss. We take a look at threat modeling. Now, what's hard is that the way in which we threat model is because we're taking our experiences, we take those in our peer groups and how they threat model, and we go, well, I'm this good. I know there's people that are better or a little bit worse. I know they can do these things. And we're never going to translate that to business, because they're never going to believe that at any moment like this, it's that easy to compromise the system. So I had to start figuring out, to me, what way in which are they going to accept at least partial wins. I'm not sure that I've got it down yet. Because they're worried about putting out a product, they're worried about how they are going to look in front of their stockholders and in front of the board. And a lot of that is sometimes rushing the market. Sometimes it is putting out something that may not be as good as you want it to be, because they're worried about the business. So at Silent Circle, what I had to implement was which you've probably seen quite a bit in the news about, at least from Silent Circle, that we patch our systems, which is gets into a different lesson later. But part of that was I had to get everyone to agree that based on an independent scoring, so not me saying it's critical, not anyone on my team saying it's critical, but utilizing the CVSS, which is, you know, what's very industry common, major and higher. So things that were 7 and higher that we would patch once it became public in less than 72 hours. So far we have done this, but also this means internal systems, because it's great for the products patched, but our internal systems, which contain customer database, they also need to be patched. Our mail servers need to be patched. Our endpoints need to be patched. And so those major and higher, we make sure that they are. There's always a debate, open source versus closed source. I don't buy into either side. Because, again, another, sorry about all the sports analogies, but I happen to enjoy them. To me, a great leader is going to create a playbook based on the talents of your team, not on based on my talents. And so I don't necessarily care if it's open source or closed source. I'm technology agnostic. I have, here's the process, here's the goals that we need to achieve as an organization. You figure out which tool is the one because you're behind the keyboard operating it. So I don't care. I don't care if you want to use, you know, a Linux. I don't care if you want to, well, I do kind of care, sorry, Microsoft. I care a little bit if you're using Microsoft. We don't use a whole lot of Microsoft at Silent Circle. Primarily, it's just our, you know, it's just Microsoft Exchange. Can't really get away from Microsoft Exchange, but I don't care if it's open source or closed source. I'm not the one using it. But whatever tool that you want to put in place, make sure you know it well. Make sure your team knows it well. Because in the event that an incident occurs, in the event that something was missed, and you said, okay, I, this is what my team is going to use, you're going to be one held accountable. I get this a lot, you know, from a person who runs our security operations. All he wants is open source, open source. Microsoft is the devil, Amazon's CIA, Google is NSA. It's a constant battle. I don't really buy into all the conspiracy theories either. Everything is compromised as far as I'm concerned until proven otherwise. Though personally, you know, myself, I do use more open source. I mean, even though I have a Mac, I'm primarily using Arch Linux on it. So again, it's not what I, it, this is because I'm using it. I don't call my IT team to help me figure out some problem with Arch. I figured it out myself. I'm willing to go through that pain. But I'm not going to put my end users through that because they won't go through it. Lesson 3, endpoint still matters. So I think, and really from the technology perspective, if you do 3 things well in your organization, if you had to pick 3, it would be endpoint, vulnerability management, identification, and then patch management. If you do those 3 things well, you will significantly improve your risk posture. And I didn't realize, I mean, I thought conceptually thought this, but when I was running the security practice for the federal group at Acumon, it's always sending out consultants to do security assessments. It was all the time. These government organizations, they wanted an independent security assessment. They didn't believe that the system integrator they had in place was providing them the right information. Shocker, when you put something out, the lowest price technically acceptable, that you're not quite sure if you're going to get what you're paying for because you chose to go with the lowest bidder. This is very common. The reason why VPN was compromised is the reason why a lot of them happen like this, because they only care about low cost. And technically acceptable is very subjective. I'm still not quite sure what technically acceptable means from a government perspective. Very good friend of mine, deputy director of DHS, and I continue asking, what does this mean? And really, it just means lowest price. So when we take a look at endpoint, this is where the compromise is really going to occur to me. Because it doesn't matter if it's a server, it doesn't matter if it's a router, firewall, laptop. End users are always the weakest link. How many of you all connected to the nice, lovely open Wi-Fi here? Did you at least use a VPN? So I was out speaking to this financial, and asked me the question, what do you think about hotel Wi-Fi? What do you mean, what do I think about hotel Wi-Fi? Well, should I tether or not? I said, well, I'm not connecting to the hotel Wi-Fi. I'm gonna save my $10. Well, why is that? Because if I was going to attack a hotel, I'm going to attack them sometime between Monday and Thursday, because that's when business people are there. And that's when they're probably using their business credit cards, that they're more than likely not checking very often. They probably have a very high credit limit. And that's when I would go down there. And I was debating bringing my phone pad in here and having some fun, but Alyssa talked me out of that. She said it wouldn't be nice to troll everyone at the conference at once. Especially
we should save that for San Francisco.
Yeah. So I didn't. I left it at home. I just brought my iPad. So the reason why I bring that up is because that endpoint, your end users, are always going to be your weakest link. No matter what you do, they're going to be your weakest link. There's no way around it. So at this conference, when the person asked me this, I said, you know, in high school, we start learning about safe sex. So if you're going to use public Wi-Fi, for the love of God, use a VPN. So at least then you can have some type of safety. And I got a very similar response. And then someone came up to me at the end of the conference and said, I can't believe you actually compared a VPN on public Wi-Fi to a condom. And I said, well, I didn't actually say that. This is what you thought. But our endpoints have everything. So when you're... Let me get back to this compliance aspect with endpoints. What are we going to put on there? There's whitelisting, there's blacklisting, there's antivirus, which I haven't run antivirus on any system I've had in, I don't know, 6 or 7 years, probably since I worked for McAfee and know it's all snake oil. I would never say for your end user not to have it, because they're probably going to go to some website that will probably have some type of drive-by download on there. But they kind of need it. I just haven't used it mainly because I know how easy it is to bypass. And definitely don't use McAfee because they are snake oil. They probably don't like me saying that. I actually got in trouble several times. I get in trouble a lot. I didn't choose to work for McAfee at the beginning. I worked for this company called Secure Computing, and I gave a presentation at the Department of Energy Security Conference. And in there, I had said that antivirus was equivalent to the bad guy is in your home, he's in your kitchen, he's drinking your beer, you're just trying to protect it from going up to the master bedroom. I mean, if they're already that far into your network, you have bigger problems than that one piece of malware. It's how do they get in, and how are they getting the data out? I mean, you should have other things that are protecting you, or at least identifying that data is being exfiltrated. So, and then of course, vulnerability management. So I spent a lot of time at Silent Circle and at career organizations just trying to get vulnerability management working as effective as I can, because it's still flawed. I mean, in order to get some type of information out of any vulnerability scanner, I have to give root access on that system in order to see what's really running. So now I have a location where every vulnerability, every library is stored on my network. So if I was an attacker, that's exactly where I would want to go, because I now know where everything is. And then I started trying to take a look at it in a different way. I want to know when a new service pops up. I want to know when a new IP address occurs. Because when you start taking a look at any type of bot, any type of a new service is going to pop up on that endpoint. And if I can compare that to my gold image, whatever I originally was supposed to have, or whatever was in my Ansible playbooks, I would then be able to say, this is probably bad. Which is what we use at Silent Circle. We take that and then we always upload it to the production systems. So if that system is compromised, then all hell breaks loose. But I'm constantly monitoring that system in order to identify whether or not something changes. If I all of a sudden I have a server and it starts broadcasting out on another port, why? And that's what I use vulnerability management for. And of course you can just use this on an end map, but I'm trying to close the threat window faster all the time. Because if I can keep the threat window closed, then my overall area of exposure is also diminished. I'm never going to stop vulnerabilities. The defense game is a losing battle. Offense, you only need to be right one time out of a billion, and you're famous. if I'm wrong one time out of a billion, I'm out of a job. Kind of let that aspect, the aspect of, I know I'm in a non-winnable situation. It's a challenge. So far, I've been lucky, I think. But I use vulnerability management to identify these new services that are popping up, and I know why. And then, lesson one, for the love of whatever you may worship, God, money, Linux, doesn't matter, patch your systems. Please just patch your systems. I can't tell you how many times I walk by an end user or my dad, which is kind of funny because he taught me most about computers, and now I'm the one having to constantly fix his systems. But he doesn't patch his systems. Every time I go over there, he's got this big warning message saying, hey, you've got a Microsoft update available. Because it's convenience. Our end users will always choose convenience over security. And so if we cannot make security easier for them, then they will always bypass that patch because it takes time. So thankfully we have systems out there like NACs and things of that nature that will force them to upgrade after a certain point. And then, you know, I get the nasty brand emails constantly on why did we do this, why did we do that, this system broke, got a patch. I mean, take a look at, let's take Apple for example. When they typically put out a patch, it has a number of vulnerabilities they've closed. And Apple does a pretty good job of this. They make a really secure products, especially for the masses, and they put out all the vulnerabilities that are in that particular release. Sooner you patch, the sooner you're no longer susceptible. Because I know I'm lazy when it comes to some of my pen testing and hacking, so I'm gonna take the easy way out, and if I can find a known vulnerability, then that's the way I'm gonna go. I'm not gonna spend countless hours trying to find a zero day. That takes too long. I don't have the time for that. I just wanna drop my exploit, yeah. So, we patch all the time. As a matter of fact, it's 9:40-ish, right? Yep, 9:40. So right now, the last patch for the stage fright vulnerability just was released for Blackphone. So we can again say that we're patched first out of everyone. And this is something that I take, you know, quite a bit to heart. Mainly because I know that if they're patched, then it's going to be hard to exploit. And this kind of also, you know, for those that were following it, two DEF CONs ago, John Sawyer exploited, you know, the first Blackphone in a patch that we had already released. Kudos to him because it was something that we had originally missed about a week before DEF CON, and we put it out the next day because we're constantly taking a look at our systems. We're constantly, which is another great part, our bug bounty program. This is what I find again, because if they can find a vulnerability, then they can get it to me faster, and then I can patch it faster. But here's the business aspect to that. There was debate internally at Silent Circles of whether or not we should do a bug bounty program or not. I was on the fence. Then, and John and I had several long debates. We had several long debates with some of the other execs there, and in the end, we decided to do it. So over a 9-month period, we're going to figure out, well, how successful is this bug bounty program? And so business people care about money. Money coming in, money going out. So over 9 months, I tracked what we were spending in third-party pen testing and what we were spending on the bug bounty program. All right, now, what I'm not saying is don't do third-party pen testing. But in that 9-month time period, we spent a little over $200,000 found 11 significant vulnerabilities. That same 9-month time period, through the bug bounty program, I spent $47,000 in change, and we found 66 significant vulnerabilities. So from the business people, it was, hey, we're paying $18,000 in change for a vulnerability over here, third parties, and an average payout of $560 through the bug bounty program. So the business people were like, wow, this is great. So when it came time to budget time this year, and was I going to take that money that was spending third-party pen testing? Now, we still need to do it, because if you're going to try and sell a product to any of the big organizations out there, They want to see that someone has reviewed it, and they don't care about your bug bounty. It's nice, but they don't care about that. They want to know who's validated. So you still need to do it. I just now shifted that to once a year rather than basically every month. And it's worked out well because we have found everything from stage fright. We have found other exploits that would have been very damaging to Android. And then I start getting criticized on, oh my gosh, you advertise, you pay $128 per bug. Well, if my average is $560, then I'm really not paying a whole lot of $128. The $128 ones are, someone went through, they used OpenBoss or something like that, and they scanned the system, we missed it, they used some automated tool, so they got their $128. Thank you, because we missed it. Now, you find a vulnerability, you provide me where it is in the product that's wrong, you provide me proof of concept exploit, you provide me a patch or prospective patch, I pay out a lot more. And for stage fright, we pay out the exact same amount as what Google paid JBug as well. We're a company that does not have billions of dollars like Google. We're also not collecting the amount of data that Google's collecting. But we pay out the same amount as what they did, and they're a big company. As Silent Circle grows, so too will our rewards. But patching, that's probably the most significant way in which you can increase your risk posture. Just keep it patched. And then the last thing. I really strongly believe that everyone can benefit from having a mentor and also having people to mentor. This has helped me out quite a bit because I was very lucky to have some very good mentors when I was first getting into this industry. And then I've even been more lucky to have a lot of people that I can mentor. I gain a lot of them through, I teach adjunct at Capital Tech University over in Maryland, and get a lot of opportunities to mentor people. And I probably learn more from mentoring than I have at any other point in my career. And I think it's something that everyone should have on both sides of the equation. Because it's good to help be able to see someone grow. And I tell, just the other day, my person who runs our help desk, he was asking, well, hey, how could you be my mentor? It's really kind of a hard thing to answer. But what I tell them is, look, what you're trying to do when you're trying to get a mentor as someone that's just entering the field is, what are they into? Do they drink coffee? Do they get a soda? Make it short, 15 minutes. Hey, do you have time for a cup of coffee? Yeah, there's a Starbucks across the street. I like this time of year because I get my pumpkin spice lattes. I always get made fun of for them, but I happen to like the way they taste. So I still do that. I get made fun of all the time, but I enjoy them. So we went across the street. I had my pumpkin spice latte. I don't know what he had. And he learned that it just takes 15 minutes. Come prepared. So in the event that you decide you're going to mentor someone, make sure they know this. Come prepared. Come with your questions. Make it short. That way it's not something that's taking up a lot of their time, and it's not a lot of their time. So those are the lessons that I've learned in order to get me where